So hello everybody, welcome to our event, the lecture of today. And today we are back to AI and looking at the worldwide governance and regulation. And I think this is a really timely talk. Let's say on the general context, we see very rapid development in AI, but what we also see is something where governments and international organizations are also reacting rather quickly. It's nearly something like, let's say, a competition between those who develop the systems and those who are trying to regulate it. So I'm really happy to welcome Marc Rotenberg. He's an expert in the field, and he will give the lecture of today. And I will act as the moderator. Just telling you the choreography is the same as always. So we have a talk for 30 minutes, and then 30 minutes Q&A. Where I will act as the moderator. In the end, we have, as always, a short piece of music proposed by Marc, and this will then be played by Peter. Some words to Marc Rotenberg. I think most of you know him already, but just to mention something, he's one of the really worldwide leading experts in, let's say, AI policy frameworks and data protection. He also did one of the first international comparative law studies on AI and democratic values, where he also provided something like a benchmark to compare national and international initiatives. He is the president or vice president and founder of the Center for AI and Digital Policy. He served on many international advisory panels, and he is a frequent speaker before the US Congress, also the European Parliament, the OECD, and UNESCO, and at many international conferences. I just want to mention also that you were visiting professor at TU Wien here, which is, we are happy to have you here. He also supported to draft the universal guidelines for AI, providing a framework for regulation of AI. He wrote several textbooks and papers. He teaches at Georgetown Law, and he is a graduate of Harvard, Stanford Law School, and Georgetown Law. Marc, thank you for being with us, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Hans, and to all my friends at TUVN. It's great to see you. I'm grateful for this opportunity to speak today. I'm going to jump right in with a slide presentation, go about 25, 30 minutes, and welcome your questions. I do think we are meeting at a very interesting moment. As many of you know, the EU AI Act is essentially final. The United Nations has just adopted a resolution in the General Assembly on artificial intelligence. We've had a lot of activity in the US, UNESCO recommendation on AI ethics, and also looking forward to the Council of Europe AI treaty. In most simple terms, I will say that when historians look back on this, let's call it a 5-year period, this may well be the defining moment when humankind confronted directly the question of how best to manage this new technology that we call artificial intelligence, and to do so through democratic institutions and legal frameworks. And for me, that's actually quite exciting. It represents, I think, an achievement of sorts. Of course, the rapid evolution of all of these various frameworks for the governance of AI raises its own set of questions. And so what I propose to do today is first to provide for you a bit of background, how we got to this moment in time, and then to explore some of the questions I think we will need to answer as we move into what we might call the second or perhaps even third era of AI governance. So to briefly explain my taxonomy, I refer to the first era of the development of principles, soft law, codes of ethics, understandings in professional associations such as ACM and the IEEE for how to manage AI. We might then refer to our second period as the adoption of laws and norms for the governance of AI. And now we move into the implementation and enforcement era, which I believe is where we are now, roughly mid-2024. But to explain how we got to this moment, let me first of all say a few words about our organization, the Center for AI and Digital Policy, which was established to promote democratic values. And I use that term democratic in the broad philosophical sense, not in terms of allegiance to a particular party. We think about openness, we think about pluralism, we think about transparency, we think about the protection of fundamental rights. And we try to assess these national strategies and international strategies for the governance of AI through this lens. When I did the first compendium about 5 years ago, I was particularly interested in this issue, the political evaluation of AI policy. It's clear that we have a lot of methods and reports to evaluate patents issued, dollars invested, papers published. We were trying to develop a methodology so that we could answer questions, which was also the topic for my paper for Hans's book, how do we align our AI policies with human rights and with democratic values. I won't go through in detail our entire methodology, but I am providing for you the questions that we have a research team every year look at as they evaluate. In our most recent report, 80 countries around the world, we assessed, rated, and ranked. And we were able on this essentially 0 to 12 scale, try to see how countries were doing in their national AI policies and practices. Some of the terms and frameworks, I think, would be familiar to you. Some of them are emerging fairly rapidly. And as a consequence, we have adjusted our methodology over time to take account of these new governance frameworks as they come into place. So this is our methodology, our 12 questions we ask of every country. We have just completed our fourth AI and Democratic Values Index. And for any participants in our research team, I just want to take a moment and thank you for your contribution. This most recent report, as I said, covers about 80 countries. It runs almost 1,600 pages. We had a network of 500 people over 90 countries providing for us their assessment and analysis, which we review and ultimately publish as a detailed narrative. And also with, as I said, ratings and rankings. And so we have here the five tiers in our evaluation. And I've given you, because the type is so small on the full graph, I've given you a snapshot of the countries toward the top. Austria is doing well, by the way. You're at the top of tier two. If you look carefully across the chart, we've typically seen Canada, Japan, and Korea in the top tier. Joined recently this past year by UK, Colombia, Netherlands, and Slovenia. Now, I'm providing this background for you as a bit of an entry point. This is an empirical analysis, but it's also important to understand that in our empirical analysis, we are trying to assess the progress that countries are making as measured against AI governance frameworks. So when we started, for example, we did our first report in 2020, we had really only the OECD AI principles, which had then been also adopted by the G20 countries. And almost immediately we had to answer the question, well, how many countries have endorsed these principles? And then I think correctly, we asked another related question, which was how many countries have implemented these principles. Because of course, it's quite easy for countries to make a declaration and to say, well, yes, we agree with all of these wonderful things, but to actually get countries to take the next step, which is to formally create the agencies, to establish the legal rules, to bring the enforcement action. All of those activities are much bigger challenge. And as I said, when we started originally, we had really only the OECD AI principles in the AI realm, because we wanted to anchor our report in traditional notions of human rights. We also included the Universal Declaration for Human Rights, which is a foundational document for the United Nations, as one of our key reference metrics, both endorsement by governments as well as implementation by governments. But you see, this is rapidly evolving because now we have new norms that we need to incorporate into our empirical analysis, including specifically the UNESCO recommendation on AI ethics. Now, I was, as some of you know, involved in the drafting of the OECD AI principles, quite proud of the work. It was the first global governance framework, but we would also consider this a form of soft law because the OECD has no legal authority over any of its member states. It can simply encourage countries to comply with the obligations that they have made, which is oftentimes the way things operate at the international level. Nonetheless, it was important to get countries in 2019 to back basic framework principles. And it was particularly rewarding, I would say, that same year when the G20 countries, which include, of course, Russia, China, Brazil, and India, adopted the OECD AI principles as well. And so we now know those principles as the G20 guidelines. And you see from the OECD back when this happened, this was a significant starting point. I'll mention also, as we think about the evolution of norms for the global governance of AI, the same time we were doing the work with the OECD, we also recognized a need to establish a framework that had, let's say, a stronger human rights focus. I would say the OECD has typically done fairly good work on economic cooperation and democratic values, but it is not as such a human rights organization. And so to address some of the harder challenges in the human rights realm, we developed and promoted a governance framework that tackled some of the more controversial types of AI deployment, including, for example, the use of AI systems for mass surveillance, which became a big issue in the drafting of the EU AI Act. You may recall the debate over remote biometric identification. That was actually one of the most contentious issues between the Parliament and the Commission and others, as well as the use of AI systems for social scoring, which is a practice that the Chinese government has adopted to try to promote, I would say, a sort of allegiance or patriotism to the national government. So these issues are put forward, in fact, in the Universal Guidelines, which preceded the release of the OECD AI principles, but actually became quite influential as they were often incorporated in various ways in the governance frameworks that were adopted. The Universal Guidelines have the advantage, frankly, over some of the other governance frameworks of being simply stated. Of course, if you make your way through the EU AI Act, you probably should get a star or medal or trophy or a good part of a law degree, because it's quite a complicated text, but an important text to be sure. With this governance framework, we were aiming to be very simple and straightforward, to use terminology that would be readily understood, not only by the experts, but also by the general public, people in law and people in computer science and others. So now we've mentioned two governance frameworks, OECD/G20. That's the one from 2019. We've mentioned the Universal Guidelines for AI. And then in 2021, UNESCO, quite remarkably, with the support of all 193 member states at the time, releases the recommendation on the ethics of artificial intelligence. And one of the first things you become aware of if you begin to track the evolution of AI governance is how new issues are taken on board as new AI applications are considered and new social and political questions are identified. So, for example, in the early days, which is to say about 5 years ago, of AI governance, where we thought of AI primarily in terms of the automated decision making, we focused on such issues as fairness, accountability, transparency, human-centric, trustworthy. These were all key terms in many of the governance documents 5 years ago. But when UNESCO reached out on a global basis and began to consider a wider range of concerns arising from the deployment of AI, you then began to see a focus on such issues as gender equity, the composition of the workforce, for example, or sustainability, the impact that AI systems were having on energy demands. And I think UNESCO was very prescient in identifying these issues, incorporating them in the report on the ethics of artificial intelligence, as well as putting forward new methodologies and new reference frameworks for evaluating progress. So with the UNESCO recommendation, you have the readiness assessment methodology to help countries, particularly in the global south, prepare for AI adoption. You also had ethical impact assessments in the UNESCO framing for AI governance. And remarkably, not only was this approach adopted by 193 countries who were members of UNESCO in 2021, but the United States this past year actually rejoined UNESCO. As some of you may be aware, it's been a bit of a political matter for the U.S. and a few other states regarding participation in UNESCO, but the U.S., and I think this is very positive, rejoined UNESCO, citing the agency's work in support of artificial intelligence. So this has not only expanded our understanding of AI governance, it's also increased the community of countries participating in AI governance. One of the issues that I continue to be fascinated by and am following closely is how courts are responding as they think about governance models. We're currently working on a new textbook to try to understand how these norms are being interpreted through the lens of national law and international norm. And I'm particularly interested in how we distinguish the new form of AI, which we'll call simply machine learning, probabilistic techniques, statistical inference, whichever characterization works best, from a more traditional understanding of AI, which was the deterministic rule-based expert system. And I did grow up in the era of the rule-based expert systems, where you had transparent logic that you could evaluate and assess. And, you know, of course, it was quite significant back in 1997 when an IBM program called Deep Blue beat the world chess champion, Garry Kasparov. But the logic of Deep Blue and the way that moves were produced could be comprehended by the programmers. And that particular program represented the expertise of many grandmasters that had been distilled into the program that was able to beat a world champion. Something entirely different happened 20 years later, when a modern machine learning program using probabilistic technique beat that old-fashioned brute force program. This was AlphaZero's defeat of Stockfish. And what was most remarkable in that moment, and the reason I continue to call attention to it, is as impressive as the outcome was, the chess grandmasters were completely befuddled, because you couldn't prove in the logical sense how the moves were produced. But the moves, to be sure, were impressive, and the program itself left no doubt that this technique was superior to prior techniques. And I think it's worth keeping this example in mind as we think about AI governance, because we are increasingly confronting systems that are producing very impressive speech, art, composition, visual images, computer code, still with the reality that we can't fully prove or assess how these outputs are produced. And as I said, we experienced this in the chess world very early on. It's really had kind of a humbling impact. And at the same time, it is also a form of warning. So, you know, as I said, I've spent some time thinking about this particular problem, but then thinking about it through the lens of governance, and it is one of the other strands that we need to pull together as we understand this moment in time. I was actually quite struck by an opinion from the Court of Justice of the European Union just 2 years ago involving the screening of air passengers and a determination as to who was considered a risk to public safety and should be pulled aside for additional screening. And I think with great insight in this opinion, the Court of Justice made a very purposeful distinction between AI systems where it was possible to examine the logic and to prove the outcome and to give people the opportunity to challenge an adverse decision, as compared with a probabilistic technique where it was essentially the machine that was determining outcomes that humans could not assess. And the way I read this opinion is essentially to say that at least in decisions concerning fundamental rights, according to the Court of Justice, it's okay to use these rule-based expert systems where we can prove outcomes, but it's not okay to use machine learning systems where the outcomes are essentially the result of a black box. This could be one of the most powerful governance norms going forward. A critical question that we're going to come back to in a moment is to what extent, in fact, governments and courts will be prepared to enforce it. Well, in addition to our evolving court norms and our global frameworks, we've had activity in the United States. I was personally very pleased by a hearing last year in the United States Senate where we saw meaningful progress on legislation. I am a little bit less optimistic at this moment. We are approaching the end of our Congress. It's, you know, similar in the EU. You're about to have parliamentary elections and a new commission. There is a sense in which there's a reset that takes place. So anything that happens is likely to happen over the next few months. I remain optimistic. I wrote another column, you know, later in the year where suddenly we saw an explosion of activity both in the US and around the world. I, you know, borrowed from that wonderful movie, Everything Everywhere All at Once. So we are certainly seeing progress, including on the US side, President Biden's executive order on safe, secure, and trustworthy AI. And this is the primary US contribution in this time period to AI governance. In some respects, it looks a bit like the EU AI Act. There's certainly some effort to create accountability for foundational models with standards and testing, but this is not a regulatory framework like legislation. This is primarily the president using his authority in the management of the federal agencies in the executive branch to say the requirements that the federal agencies must follow in their deployment of AI systems. It's far-reaching as a historical matter. It's the most comprehensive executive order issued by a U.S. president. So I think this is certainly important to take note of. But its scope is, in fact, limited. It does not directly regulate the big AI firms like OpenAI and Anthropic and Google and Facebook and others, other than through certain limited standard setting obligations through the Department of Commerce and some watermarking obligations that exist. So it does leave a lot of questions open. We're going to go in a moment to talk about how we assess these governance frameworks. I did want to also call attention to a pending complaint that we have at the Federal Trade Commission regarding OpenAI. We filed this a little bit more than a year ago. I think it's actually a very good complaint. It basically asks the U.S. federal agency responsible for consumer protection to open an investigation and to bring legal proceedings against OpenAI concerning the consumer product ChatGPT. We wrote a detailed 45-page legal argument that was later supplemented with additional filings, relying largely on what OpenAI, the company itself, had said would be risks in the release of their product concerning disinformation, concerning cybersecurity, concerning children's safety. Some of this evidence was acquired from experts. Some of it was stated directly by OpenAI itself. And so we continue to wait for the FTC to act. We have seen enforcement taken by the Italian Data Protection Agency, actually acted quite quickly last year. We've seen action taken in Japan and Korea, in Canada. I believe investigations have been open in Spain, and also some coordination among the European Data Protection Board. So, you know, we'll wait and see what happens on that front. We did receive some good news last summer, which was that the FTC had, in fact, opened the investigation, but we are very concerned about the delay that seems to be apparent at this moment and hope the FTC will act. Finally, I'm going to mention the Council of Europe AI Treaty. We've spent several years working on this. I think the outcome is not quite what was hoped for. We anticipated a treaty that would regulate AI systems across all sectors. Some of the non-member states of the Council of Europe who do have the opportunity to ratify the treaty said they would prefer to keep the focus on AI systems in the public sector and leave open the question of whether the regulation should apply to private sector AI systems. Personally, I think this was a mistake as a matter of AI governance. I think it was also a political mistake, as the member states of the Council of Europe would have preferred a more comprehensive treaty and went for this compromise, hoping to get non-member states to participate. So we were involved in a bit of a campaign to try to urge the Council of Europe to adopt a more robust treaty. Nonetheless, I would not diminish the significance of the outcome. I think the Council of Europe AI Treaty, along with the EU AI Act and a number of the other emerging norms for the governance of AI, are going to place us all in this very interesting position, which is where I'm going to pause for a moment, is how do we think about this moment in time? And as I said, I think we're now in, let's call it the third era of AI governance. Again, in summary, our first era was ethical principles and soft law. Our second era was the adoption of hard law and the creation of new legal instruments. But now here we are, you know, with these governance structures in place. And so we begin to ask, you know, some very interesting questions. How do we coordinate compliance? How do we move forward with implementation and enforcement to see that these words on paper are actually given real meaning? We know from the data protection era and, you know, going back to the 1990s and the, you know, sharply different approaches that the US and the EU took to data protection, that there is a real risk of divergence. For people who are familiar with the GDPR history, you may recall Safe Harbor, and then we had whatever, Privacy Shield, and now we're on to the data privacy framework. Bridging the EU-US regulatory divide is important both as a matter of theory. It's also important as a matter of practice, because of course there's so much trade that takes place between the US and the EU that this issue will need to be solved. I'll take a moment also to mention a very good book by Anu Bradford, as a professor at Columbia Law School, has written on digital empires, looking in particular at the various approach to regulation. As I mentioned earlier, with regard to the PNR system and the judgment of the Court of Justice, I am absolutely fascinated by the question of where there will be prohibitions on AI systems. The UNESCO recommendation on AI ethics had two prohibitions. The EU AI Act actually has seven categories of prohibition or near prohibition. The White House executive order aims to prohibit AI systems that are, quote, rights impacting or safety impacting that fail to meet minimum practices. And so, of course, we will be looking closely to see how those decisions are being made. As you might imagine, those in the private sector and who favor innovation are very uneasy about the thought that there could be prohibitions on AI systems. But I think it's also important to remind people that certainly in the realm of industrialization and environmental impact, we're very familiar with the need for environmental impact assessments to ensure that, you know, we have water that we can drink and air that we can breathe. And we make decisions all the time about how industries are allowed or not allowed to build factories and release certain products. And I think we will need to adopt a similar approach with regard to the deployment of AI systems. And finally, even though we've seen so much formation of AI governance frameworks over the last few years, I'm still looking here in the US to our Senate to carry forward legislation. There are several very good proposals that have, as we would say, bipartisan support from Democrats and Republicans that could be adopted. And we also have our complaint in the Federal Trade Commission that we hope the FTC will act on. So we put all of that under the category of unfinished business. And finally, for those who are interested, I just want to mention here in Washington, but you're all welcome to join us in 2 days. We will have Gabriela Ramos, who's Assistant Director General of UNESCO, talking about implementation of the recommendation on AI ethics. Finally, I think, is our famous laptop sticker, coffee coaster. For those who'd like more information about us, you can find us online. And I will stop here and happy to answer your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Marc, for this excellent presentation and talk. I'm taking questions now. I have seen one person raising her hand. It's Pamela Geyer. We can see you, but let's see whether we can hear you. Pamela, your screen is out.
Can you hear me? This is actually Moshe. I'm using my wife's computer. Can
you
hear
me? Moshe. Okay.
Okay. So thank you, Marc, for this comprehensive review. Now, I'd like to think about the implication on, especially on individual consumer in the United States. Because everything, whenever we use technology, we sign a contract with a company, it's called a click-through license. And usually this waives a lot of stuff. So my question is, I mean, I suspect that soft law means nothing because we waived our rights there. How much hard law left after we have signed away our practically everything through click-through licenses?
Well, first of all, Moshe, thank you very much for joining the talk. You've certainly been a big inspiration for a lot of the work that we've been doing. I'll answer in two parts. The EU AI Act does regulate AI as a consumer service, but those companies that develop and deploy AI systems will not be able to get out of their obligations under the Act through click-through agreements. And I think that is good news. I share your concerns, by the way. I've said this for many, many years. You know, notice is not privacy protection. Most privacy policies actually operate as the opposite of protection obligations. They operate as waivers or disclaimers. So this is a well-known problem in consumer law. I think the US FTC has struggled a bit because they continue to believe that if you get a notice, you can make an informed decision. But in fact, this is not, for a variety of reasons, how it works in practice. So on the EU side, as I said, I think the EU AI Act makes pretty clear that companies cannot disclaim their obligations through click-through agreements. Now, you understand, therefore, the sort of the logic and the purpose of our complaint to the FTC regarding OpenAI a year ago, because this is precisely what we were trying to accomplish on the US side when we went to the FTC and we said, you cannot rely on consumer notices when a company is releasing a product that it itself has said poses a risk to cybersecurity or children's safety or democratic governance. But we only fix this problem on the US side if the FTC acts. So in this moment, we simply need to get the FTC to act.
Thank you.
Thank you. Edward, you were able to raise your hand now.
Yeah, sorry. Hi, Mark.
Hi.
Thanks for the very nice overview. You briefly mentioned on one slide an idea of distinguishing good AI from bad AI by whether it's rule-based. And so I would characterize these rule-based systems like the old-fashioned expert system concepts as being sort of intrinsically limited by, you know, Herb Simon's bounded rationality, right? You have to be able to reason through it at a human level. And one of the things that we're seeing with the AIs, however, is that there's, you know, I mean, in some sense, there's a class of problems that they're being applied to for which you could apply this criterion, but there's a class of problems where it's going to be much harder. And I think these classes are getting blurred. So take, for example, self-driving cars. I think that, you know, for decades, since the 1990s, people have been trying to build self-driving vehicles using rule-based techniques, and they failed. They're proven ineffective. And so the self-driving cars that you see today are actually blending rule-based with machine learning and reinforcement learning based techniques, and they're much more effective. And I think that we're seeing this also emerging in robotics and in a lot of other applications of AI where, you know, there's sort of decision making here that doesn't fall into this category of kind of the rational decision making that we might be able to use rule based criteria to determine whether it can be used or not. So I'm worried that, you know, this kind of regulation may be effectively eviscerating a whole class of very useful technologies in AI. So I was wondering if you could comment about that.
Great. Well, I think, Edward, you've actually, you know, pointed to the key question and the key tension as we think about the legal governance of AI. And I like to provide the chess example. I mean, I am a tournament chess player, and I did a lot of programming in the early days. To be sure, everyone is very impressed by what programs like AlphaZero can do. And you probably also know the history. You know, it was the game with Lee Sedol, the Korean Go master, against AlphaGo in 2016 that basically launched the Chinese AI program because people became so aware of how extraordinarily powerful these new techniques were. So I don't think there's any, you know, real dispute as to the performance outcome. But I think the question becomes very interesting when we enter the legal realm and we start to consider issues like fairness and justice. Do you want to be subject to a decision by a black box judge who provides evidence that their sentencing is more accurate and reliable than a human judge, but you don't know the factors upon which the sentence that you've received were based? And I think this is why the issue of prohibitions and red lines becomes so fascinating. because at least with regard to decisions involving people's fundamental rights, the Court of Justice was saying we need to draw some lines. And I've written elsewhere about this, by the way. I did a review of the Kissinger book, The Age of AI, and I basically said, listen, you can be impressed by a very powerful program that promotes scientific innovation and still be able to say that black boxes should not make decisions, you know, about students and employees. So that's, I think that's where I come down.
But a follow-up, I mean, couldn't the same reasoning be used to disallow decisions by human judges?
Well, I mean, we're always on, okay, maybe. So we're always concerned about bias, of course. And we're always, you know, I mean, this is a problem with humans, but I am not satisfied. And I've heard this argument many times who say, well, we can't inspect the logic of a person. Why should we have the right to inspect the logic of a machine? And to me, the question answers itself. I mean, there is an obvious difference between deferring to humanity and placing us in, you know, a society with structures that try to elevate fairness and deferring our humanity to processes that we can't control. I would always pick the first.
May I interfere as moderator, because maybe add what one approach is, was, which is taken by the European AI Act. They take this risk-based approach and they say, okay, in a specific class where you have the specific risk, you should not act on based on these AI decisions. And I think this does not, let's say, eliminate totally the, let's say, the application of these new AI tools, but it says, okay, in specific classes, you should not use them. So there are some, let's say, the lawmakers are a little bit aware of that, but I think you have raised a fundamental question here. Carlo, you are the next, and then Paloma.
Okay, thank you very much for the your presentation and the discussion that is going on. I think that, you know, when you're raising the issue of, let's say, the good AI against the bad AI, based on, the traditional AI, which is rule-based or based on logic, and the other that is based on statistical methods and probabilistic decisions. I would say that actually the problem that you're raising is the problem of having machines that can explain why they do certain things. So we can explain and we can understand why they do certain things. So explainability is the difference, you know, between the two, the bad and the good AI. But if you take that definition as, you know, explainability as the difference between bad and good, then it's not just the AI that makes the difference. You know, we sometimes build systems that are so complicated that they are hard to explain or even impossible to explain. So the I think that, you know, the issue is not just the AI component that makes the difference, but the fact that we need to rely on systems that we can explain. We can explain why they work, why they don't work. And this is not just a question of, you know, bad AI or old AI and new AI. Even, you know, as I said before, you know, very complex systems which interact, you know, in a, with in a complicated way with the environment, they can have behaviors that are very hard to explain and understand.
Yes. Well, I mean, these are all good points. And certainly I don't mean to suggest that the only problem with computer software is the black box problem. I mean, certainly there have been questions about, you know, testing and verification separate and apart. And we also have in the legal realm, you know, concerns about proprietary techniques. It's the reason that most people in the computer field tend to favor open source software. And there's a lot of debate right now about open models for AI as being preferable. But I do think as we consider decisions impacting the opportunities of people, which is a little bit different, let's say, from assessing climate change or pursuing scientific innovation or even driving autonomous vehicles. When we're assessing decisions impacting people's opportunities and education and employment and credit and housing and on it goes, there are an increasing number of ways in which techniques are being deployed that make it more difficult to assess whether the outcome was fair. And so this word explainability is actually a word that I've spent quite a bit of time thinking about. And, you know, it depends a little bit, I guess, on your language background. But you see, explainability can also convey a sense of rationale. This is the reason that you were denied this opportunity, because we considered a variety of factors and concluded you were not the right person. That, to me, is not sufficient. We would use terms like contestability. Well, what if I think you were wrong? How do I challenge your decision? Or we would use words like traceability or reproducibility. How can we show that the decision you produced in this instance was actually correct and that you didn't confuse me with someone else, which have been issues with, you know, automated decision-making for 50 years. So to me, explainability turns out to be a very thin term in terms of a guardrail or safeguard. We need to enrich it with some of these other concepts if we are going to use these techniques for decisions that impact people.
Thank you. Paloma, it's you.
Hello, and thank you for this very interesting talk from Estonia. I was wondering, because you before also said that you mentioned it, like that the AI Act, who has like, you get a prize if you can read through it. And I would completely agree.
Yes.
I'm still trying to get my head around it. And seeing also all these tasks that will be put on member states, do you see a danger that it's too complicated to be efficiently implemented and also controlled then by member states or by whoever controls then again the member states who should implement all the regulations? Thank you.
Well, the answer is yes. I do think it's a risk, and I do think the implementation challenges are substantial. I've spent a number of years teaching the GDPR, so I'm reasonably familiar with the structure of EU law. And in a lot of ways, the EU AI Act looks familiar. But it is also certainly the case that it, you know, takes up the question of certification and conformity assessment, and particularly when you get to the high risk systems, there is going to be a lot of work imposed on companies that are releasing these products and services. But from another perspective, if I may say, in some ways it doesn't seem so surprising. I mean, if you were in pharmaceuticals, or if you were in transportation, if you were in construction, any of these other domains where we make products and services available for market, there are typically lots of standards, lots of requirements, lots of independent testing. And it is part of the assessment, if you choose to develop a business, that you have to take into account moving forward. Now, the computer world, in some senses, has been very different because there's been, you know, little regulation, let's say, apart from copyright and data protection. Although, actually, I think this is going to change as well, because with, you know, certainly some of the new models on the U.S. side, where we don't have a comprehensive framework, you're seeing many more lawsuits alleging copyright violations, for example. And so you don't get away, I guess the best way to say this is, you don't get away from the legal problems or the legal challenges that almost necessarily arise with new technologies. If you don't write a law, they just tend to be resolved in a more haphazard fashion, which was the experience in the US with privacy when we decided not to do a GDPR. We've got you know, hundreds of state laws and hundreds of cases. It isn't that we didn't create privacy laws, just we did it in piecemeal fashion.
Thank you, Mark. I have also a question. I was looking up some initiatives and I saw I think China is moving into the direction of regulation, and you have also the African Union is moving into, they are already having a political document and they're discussing to have, let's say, some guidelines. And with this, I would like to come to this, let's say, geopolitical competition we have at the moment. And at the same time, I think we need a governance of AI development also on a worldwide scale. Do you see there is any chance that we could come into this direction on a, let's say, real political pace? And second, right, related to that, could the EU AI Act serve as a model for that? Let's say having a Brussels effect on that AI Act level?
Yeah, well, Hans, these are all great questions. And let me try to briefly answer each point you've made. So first, China is a fascinating example of a country that is trying to dominate AI, both through innovation in the market realm, which we understand as traditional competition, in particular between China and US, but also in the regulatory realm, which has implications for the EU and others. And Anu Bradford writes about this in her book, Digital Empire. And to me, it actually tells us that far from innovation and regulation necessarily existing in a trade-off, I think some countries have really thought through how to both promote innovation and to create the regulatory environment that, you know, would most favor their industries and the political values. That's the path that China is pursuing. And the aim is, you know, by 2030 to be the dominant power. You ask a very good question about global cooperation. And I would say there are positive signs here leading up to the Bletchley Park Safety Summit that was organized by the UK last November. There was a decision to invite the Chinese government, which I think was the correct decision, and it created the opportunity for US officials and Chinese officials to talk about the development of standards, particularly to control some of the foundational models that are giving everyone concern. So we're seeing around safety issues, if not around political issues, some collaboration. The UNESCO recommendation on AI ethics as a starting point is global. The UN resolution on AI is global. The Council of Europe AI Treaty has the interesting possibility to be a global legal framework, which is to say it could be, it is binding and enforceable on those states who choose to endorse it. And it's open for ratification by non-member states. So there's a lot happening in this moment that would tend toward convergence around standards, but we're still in the early days of this third era. And I think we'll need to look a couple of years from now and see what in fact actually happened in this moment. Did countries move together on issues like the protection of human rights with regard to AI systems, or was there increasing divergence?
Thanks. If there's no further question, I have a final one, okay? And this is a more historic one. When we look now at AI and the fast development, we see that, let's say, countries and also association of countries react rather fast, rather quickly, okay? So we have this AI as a changing technology, having impact on society and political environment, and let's say states and governments react. When I compare this with the development of the web, which was fundamentally changing, let's say, the political, social, and economic environment of our world, this was, let's say, accompanied by deregulation. And we realize today that this was too much deregulated. We would have needed regulation when you see at the centralization of the power in the web. So do you have an explanation why this, let's say, we have two let's say, development on a technological level with two technologies somehow related, but both of them having a big economic, societal, political impact. And one was, let's say, deregulated, and the other one is accompanied by regulation. Do you have an explanation for that from a...
I think it's a great contrast, actually, that you raise, and also gives us the opportunity to put this moment in a somewhat broader historic context. And the brief answer, of course, is that the United States adopted Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act, which gave broad immunity to internet-based services. I supported that at the time. I was involved, in fact, in the drafting and some of the litigation. It was early days for the commercialization of the internet, and we actually lacked legal clarity as to what the standard of liability would be for the so-called intermediaries. But I think we learned pretty quickly that 230 likely had gone too far. And it was, you know, maybe 10 or 15 years later, as it became clear that companies like Google and Facebook weren't really intermediaries. They were, in fact, the dominant economic powers on the internet, that regulation was necessary. And so now in the U.S., of course, there is no support for a 230-like approach to AI and a recognition that we need to regulate sooner rather than later. But that is the big difference. The big difference was the decision on the U.S. side to give broad immunity to the early internet companies. We're not going to see that now with AI.
Thank you, Marc. Thanks a lot for your presentation. Thank to all of you who have participated in the discussion and also listened and joined us. Now we are going over to the, let's say, piece of music. And Marc, you want to say some words why you have chosen that, or we just play it?
Well, this is how I think of AI policy, and I like the Beatles, and I couldn't come up with a better song. So this is my preference. Thank you, Hans, and thank you all for joining us today.
Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks.
Thank you.
Peter, and I just the floor is yours.
I just did a quick announcement of the songs. I mean, yeah, I thought I have to share the fact that this was the original title, right? AI policy and the long and winding road, and this the talk was renamed, but we stuck to the music. I think it's a great combination here. For the next talks, for May, we're still exploring which lecture we could do. So please sign up for a newsletter or follow us on X or check the website regularly to receive updates on a talk in May. But for June, we already have confirmed two lectures back to back, actually. On June 4th, Wessel Reyers will speak on civic virtue and digital technology, and Erich Prehm will moderate. And just 1 week later, on June 11th, Gordon Birch will speak on generative AI, degrading online communities, moderated by Enrico Nardelli. So for today, thank you, Marc. Thank you, Hannes. Thank you, all of you. Thanks to all of you. And please join us again next time. Here are the Beatles. Take care and goodbye.
The long and winding road that leads to your door will never disappear. I've seen that road before. Lead me to your door. The wild and windy night that the rain washed away has left a pool of tears crying for the day.
Goodbye, everybody. See you next time.